back in the house of God. They did something. Tonight we just started yesterday. Here it is Wednesday night. Time is just so swiftly passing by. Time ain't waiting on nobody. That's the reason God says, now is the accepted time, for the day is the day of salvation. Because next minute, next hour, next week might be too late. And God planned his sins. In his work, life is uncertain, but death is for sure. And the way it's going right now, the way things is moving in our country, in our world today, I believe Jesus Christ is God on the verge of stepping out and calling us out of here.
Amen.
And so, if you ain't ready, it's going to be too late to get ready. So, you better be ready when that time comes. If it ain't getting ready, you better be ready. Because it ain't going to give you 30 minutes to get your clothes on. Give you 30 minutes to get in order. No, bless God, you better be ready to go when he calls. That's just how close we are, church.
Yeah.
We're right at the rapture of the church. And so, anyhow, we want to go to the Lord in prayer tonight. We appreciate each one coming. Good to see all of you here, Brother Bible and Sister Vicki with us tonight. And good to have Sister Rhonda's friend with her tonight. And good to see all of you here tonight, Brother Randy and his wife. And we want to pray, as Brother Junior was saying, let's remember Brother Johnny. He had his surgery on his arm today, and let's pray for him and pray for Brother Lawrence. I talked to him and had prayer with him, and he is still up in the emergency room. They're taking care of him and his breathing. I knew last night when I spoke to him, I knew Lawrence was just about in trouble. So this morning when he woke up, when he sat up on the side of the bed, he couldn't get his breath. Mm-hmm. So he told his wife, he said, son, you need to call 911. So they called Amazon out there and gave him a breathing treatment right in the house and then took him on to the hospital. So let's ring Brother Lawrence. You know, he's been a soldier down through the years. And Brother Greg, that's our Sunday school teacher.
Yeah.
And him and Brother Dean. And just pray that God will be with him. And so let's remember the lost tonight. There's Johnny Hooker. There's Naaman Chavis. There's Wayne. Daryl Lilly. And Kelly. Now, we want to remember them in prayer. And God knows who they are. And let's pray for them. Pray for all our families. You know, we got family out there that needs to get in the will of God. You know, if we get our families in churches, church will be full. That's right. I remember Brother Greg when a few years gone by, that it was nothing to have anywhere from 70 to 80, maybe 90 people on Sunday morning at church. And you know what? People has just got unconcerned. People's got tied up with the world. And some of them always, I talked to a guy today at one of our local garages up here. And he goes to one of our local churches. And he said, Brother Bobby, did you tell me that Greg Lentz is over at the church? I said, yes, sir. He's been over. I said, Sunday morning. Oh, he said, I didn't know that. I said, well, we've been on Facebook. I thought you put something on Facebook. I don't know. And we've had our posters out, get them out. And so, I put a poster down on 220 in Ashburn. I had it on the outside of the truck, and it come up a storm on me, and it blew the slam off. I said, well, I hope they don't get me for messing up the highway. Maybe the Lord lit on heart to come to me. Anyhow, we try to get the word out. And so my wife, she went up here to one of our local video stores. I'm going to call it what it is, bless God. It's a gambling store. Right up in the road. They got two of them right up the road here.
Yeah.
And she went in there and asked them if she could leave one of our revival posters on. You can leave it with me. I'll put it there. You know, it never did get put up.
Yeah.
That's like carrying one to a liquor store. Bless God, it ain't going up. Maybe dumb, but Greg, we ain't stupid. But anyhow, we get the word out. And it's going to be pink. Go ahead, sis.
I talked with John and April. They put Dreema in the hospital up in Brenner's. They said she is having seizure and trick, and they're going to start running tests on us. Pray for that child.
Who's that they put in the hospital on?
Dreema, John's granddaughter. April's daughter.
Oh, okay. Dreema. Okay, I got you. Let's remember this request. I'll tell you what, I told y'all before this revival ever started. I said, look out, get all your laundry out of the way and be wise to the tricks of the devil. Because I says, the devil does not like the word of God being preached. And I says, you can bank on it, the devil's going to try to throw torment at you. And he's going to try to hinder you from being in this revival. And now, Sister Rose had to be took to the hospital a couple of days, but thank God she's here tonight.
Amen.
And Brother Lawrence up there, and others that were sick, my wife was sick yesterday, but thank God she's here today. And I thank God for those that's been faithful and could make it. And if you couldn't make it, God understands, we understand. We're not going to crucify you because you didn't make it. We just going to love you to death and pray for you that God will help you get on in. Mm-hmm. Amen. But anyhow, I appreciate my little wife. She's always been with me everywhere I went. If I go to the hospital, she's with me. If I go visit home, she's with me. She goes with me everywhere I go if she's able to go. And I appreciate that with all my heart. God give me a wonderful help, makes Father great. Sure it is. And I thank God for her. Amen. She had to run me down, but she caught me. I'll tell y'all something, church. You may think it's wrong for a woman to come to a man. You read your Bible over what happened to Adam. Adam didn't get out there and run Eve all over the Garden of Eden. No, God put Adam to sleep. Had to get him put to sleep to where he could operate on him. And take a rib from Adam and over yonder somewhere across the Garden of Eden, he made Eve. And the Bible says when he made her, he brought her to him. That's the way it's supposed to be today, bless God. You ain't supposed to get out there and run them down. Amen. Let God bring them to you.
Amen.
Now, you run them down, you might wish you'd never found them.
They could get back some fellowship. Bless Brother Greg and his Stanford and bless every home and every family represented in the Shady Grove Baptist Church. Whoever I love, once Lord Jesus, please be saved. Remember the ones that's sick, Lord God, that couldn't be here. Bless them, Lord. Help them, Jesus. I pray for this service to be exactly what you have to be. Thank you. And I love you. In Jesus' name.
Amen. God, I pray for Rick Shirley and I say that God will pray to heaven. Let your sweet way and bless you tonight, God. Touch hearts, Lord. And save that soul here to you. Bless our nation, our leaders, our missionaries. Bless the peace of vision. For Jesus' precious name we pray.
Amen.
All right, now I want to ask you something. How many bought visitors here tonight? All right, Brother Dean's bought visitors. How many got? He's got three. All right, how many of them, who else bought visitors? All right, Sister Amy, how many you got? She's got two. And her Sister Rhonda's got one. And Sister who? Brother Aaron, he's got three.
Two.
I'm going to check my place. Anybody else bought visitors?
And I hear that, brother.
All right, how many has got the most, Sister Gerald? Anybody else?
Brother Dean?
Vino. Who?
Brother Dean's got him.
I've got 25. Brother Dean?
25.
You go, Dean. This is from the Shady Grove Baptist Church. Beautiful King James Version, yeah.
Yeah.
We don't allow NIV in the church. Non-inspired version, that's what that means. This is a King James Version.
Amen.
It's a beautiful Bible. And let's give Brother Dean a big hand for the work. Give it to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
I thank you in the name of the Lord.
I just want to thank God tonight. I didn't bring people here to win no Bible. You know, I just thank God that He blesses me no matter what.
Yes.
No matter what I do. No matter how I fall. No matter how I just stray away. When I stray away, you know, He's always with me.
Yes.
Just like Brother Greg says, you know, we've got a divine appointment. we're gonna meet, you know, and just because of God, not because of me, because he lives in my heart. And I just hope he'll so shine before me that everybody will see him and not me, because it's him, it's not me.
Amen.
And I just thank him tonight for loving me and for saving me, and let's give him all the praise and the glory for it all.
Amen. God bless you.
Amen. Amen.
We appreciate the work that others have done to get people to visit with us. And it's good to have Sister Amy's father with us tonight. He might he come with us Sunday. We appreciate him being here tonight. And I trust that maybe he'll get to come back with us more often. Now, I don't invite somebody away from that church. If you're a member of another church and you're faithful in that church, that's where you need to be. I am not a apostolic preacher. I don't steal sheep. I always figure if you cut a hole to bring them in, somebody will cut a hole to take them out. In other words, like your preacher said one time, if I can lead them in with a hamburger, somebody will lead them out with a hot dog. Amen. But anyhow, it's good to be here. Let's everybody stand tonight, and ushers come up tonight. Let's take up our offering. Amen. God bless you.
Jesus rode into Jerusalem.
Lord.
But tonight, we're gonna turn it over to Brother Greg. So finish the service out. So y'all like to give the man of God plenty of time.
Amen.
Brother Greg, we appreciate you being here. Lord, it seems like it just started. A lot of y'all don't know it, but Sunday morning, this man here, Brother Greg Lynch, drove all the way from Asheville, North Carolina, to Shady Grove Baptist Church, to be in our service Sunday morning. And that's the determination to meet you upon it and to do what God wants you to do. And I appreciate Brother Greg. I appreciate it with all my heart. He has strictly been an uplift to my heart, and I know he's been uplifted to this church.
Amen.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you for being in God's house tonight, and trust that God can speak to us in the service tonight. At least you got some in this for us. And I want to say thank you to my family and everyone coming and being part of the service this week. And pray for Jill. She's not feeling too well tonight either. And everything that's going around with everybody, but you pray for her. And Henderson started school yesterday and doing good. So praise the Lord for that. But again, thank you for being here. Don't forget, if you didn't get the book, Sounds from Heaven, Lisa's taking those orders back there after the service. And we'll get those to the church and get those delivered to you. And I love it when there's something that can help. Love it when something can help the Lord's people. And this book talks about the lineage of our president, Donald J. Trump, and the family that he came from over in Skye, in England and Scotland, and that part of the country and part of the world. And they made an announcement today that Donald Trump has been the greatest friend that Israel has ever had.
Amen.
And so there's no accident, as I said, at the beginning, God put him in there for a certain time and a reason. And God said that if we'll love them, he'll love us.
Uh-huh.
And as long as we keep Israel in the main focus of what we do, understanding that's the apple of God's eye, and taking care of them, God will bless America.
Yeah.
And so I appreciate our president moving the embassy to Jerusalem. And then being such a friend to the people of faith, and so it's such an encouragement. If you haven't got that, pick that up on your way out. And then also, if you would like the information on the television program, that information is back there. And then your church helps us every month with the Rise Up and Build program. And if you'd like to get some information about that, newsletters back there, all of that information, preaching tapes, and then if you would like to help with the dip jar, she'll have that out after the service. And then that helps us to buy the food that we fix the food boxes with to send out in times of disaster. And that's already set up as a $20 love gift. Those boxes average about $20 time to put all the items in it. We were able to start a new program with our local police department there in Asheville and try to be a blessing and a help to them. And so we delivered a load of those boxes before we came down here last week to help our own community. And then not only do we help our community, but then anytime there's a major disaster, we try to respond to them as well. So again, thank you for allowing us the privilege to be here this week. I hope and trust it's been a blessing to your life and a blessing to you. And if you'll take your Bible and get ready as she sings, Psalms chapter number 84. And we'll begin the last service, Lord willing, this passage of Scripture, Psalms chapter number 84. We'll look at these verses together.
And we're called to walk by faith.
If there's anybody here who's found him faithful, anybody here who knows he's able, just say amen. If there's anybody here who's seen his power, anybody here brought through the fire,
mercy and his grace and his kindness toward us. And I trust that everybody in this building has got help from God this week. And that's been our desire to be here and to bring the word of God that will strengthen and encourage and help you on this spiritual journey. And if you remember, we started Sunday morning, and what did we preach on Sunday morning?
Shake it off.
So whatever you're going through, remember, there's time spiritually. You just got to shake it off and keep on going to the glory of God and understand that you're on a spiritual journey.
That's right.
And we're headed to the King's Palace.
Amen.
And we're going to be with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And no matter what we face tomorrow, that cannot stop our journey.
Amen.
And that's the good thing about it. We've read the last chapter, and we are on the winning side.
Amen.
No matter what happens this week, we're on the winning side. So we praise God for that. And I want to finish up tonight and Lord willing, get us to the house of God and the temple and the place of worship and trust that God can speak to us together. Let's pray together and then we'll begin reading and looking in Psalms chapter number 84 together. Father, thank you for this time together. I pray that it's been a blessing and an encouragement to your people. And Lord, I pray that you would encourage them again tonight. Meet every need in this place. God, give us instruction, God, of what we're to do on the way to the palace. God, on the way to heaven. God, on our way home. God, there's some things you want us to do. So, Lord, I pray that you would help us tonight. Instruct us, fill us, touch us, breathe on us. Hide us in the blood behind the cross. May Jesus be magnified in this place. And God, I pray that you would help this dear church family, these people, encourage them and bless them. And God, thank you for their support. Thank you for their help. And Lord, I pray that you bless them in a special way. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Psalms chapter number 84. And in verse number 1, how amiable are thy tabernacles, O Lord of hosts. What the psalmist is saying is, oh, how beautiful they are. If I could ever get in the courts of the Lord, how beautiful it is to dwell with the God of glory. And that should be the desire of every person inside of this building every time we come to the house of God. Oh, how beautiful it is. How wonderful it is. How marvelous it is. If I could just make it to the household of faith, I know everything is going to be all right. Everything that I've been trying to preach to you this week is trying to get you to understand the closer we get to home, the more we need each other, the more we need the household of God, the more we need the tabernacle of the Lord, the more we need the presence of God in this dark hour to help us through the difficulties of what we're facing. So the psalmist said, how amiable, how beautiful, how lovely, how wonderful, how holy, how great is thy tabernacles, O Lord of hosts. Notice verse number 2, my soul longeth, yea, even fainteth for the courts of the Lord. That should be our desire every day. God, I long for thee. I long and I yearn and I even faint if I'm not around the presence of God. Every day it should be a desire from the people of faith that we desire the things of God and to be around the presence of the Lord, because it's in his presence dwells the fullness thereof. It's in his presence that I know that I can receive help in the time of trouble. It's in his presence that I can understand that God is real and alive and well and can help me in the midst of what I'm facing. So the psalmist said, not only how beautiful are thy tabernacles, but my soul longeth, even fainteth for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cries out for the living God. Wouldn't it be something if we could get that thirsty and that hungry for God, that every day that we were awakened by God's mercies and grace, that we would just get up saying, my heart cries for the Lord, my heart longeth for the presence of God. My soul is in desperate need of God's divine touch and appointment in my life every day. And so the psalmist comes to that place where he says, my flesh and my heart cry out for the living God. Notice verse number 3, yea, the sparrow hath found a house, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young, even thine altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Then he says, blessed are they that dwell in thy house, and they that be still praising thee. And there's that little word the psalmist uses so many times, salah, which means to think on it, ponder about it, remember, reflect about all the times God has been good to
Amen.
You, and he's been good to me. And we ought to be people of praise, people of worship, people that magnify the Son of God, who is worthy of all of our praise. And the psalmist says, in the midst of this darkness, in the midst of this difficulty, may my heart yearn for thee. May my heart even come to the place of fainting after thee. And may I long for the presence and the tabernacle of thy God. And may I wander and go toward the courts of the Lord, because it's in that place I know I can find help in the time of trouble and difficulty.
Amen.
So he said in verse number 4, blessed are they that dwell in thy house, they that will be still praising thee. But notice verse number 5, blessed is the man whose strength is in thee, in whose heart are the ways of them. If I long for the Lord, if I'm praising the Lord, if I'm worshiping the Lord, if I'm spending time being busy around the things of God, then I don't have time to ponder on the things of this world and the flesh right. and the devil and his entrapments. I'll spend time wanting the things of God.
Amen.
But notice verse number 6 is where I want to get to tonight. Who passing through the valley of Baca. Notice again, here is another valley. Every time there's a valley, it Amen. Responds. And there requires a response to that valley.
Amen.
And here the psalmist is, when I come passing through the valley of Baca, that is a literal place. It's about 500 miles south of Jerusalem. And it is a place of difficulty, because it was so far away from the courts of the Lord. You got to remember, these are people that have been living in exile. These are the pilgrims that have been away from God. These are the families that have been pushed out of Jerusalem. And now they are in Egypt's territory, in the world, in the flesh, and around the people that did not know God. And in the midst of that, when they're walking in that valley, the whole time they're yearning, the whole time they're thinking, the whole time they're contemplating, oh, if I could just get back to the courts of the Lord, if I could just get back to thy house, if I could just get back to the tabernacles yeah. of God, I know everything is going to be all right. Can you imagine thousands of pilgrims? Can you imagine all of these people as they're exiled from faith and they're exiled from God and they're living down towards Saudi Arabia, 500 miles away from the house of God, 500 miles away from the place of help, 500 miles away from the place of restoration, and their heart is longing, they're desperate, and they're hungry for the household of faith. Every person inside of this building is going to come through their valley experiences. But when you get to the other side of it, you can comprehend that God was faithful every step of the way, and God helped you in the midst of your valley.
Amen.
So here the scripture said, who passing through the valley of Baca. That word Baca in your scriptures means a place of weeping and a place of tears. Yes, that valley brings tears. Yes, that valley brings discouragement. Yes, that valley is difficult. Yes, that valley brings despair a lot of times. But notice how the scripture phrases this, who passing through. There's going to be a through process. There's going to be an ending process. There's going to be a time when we are going to pass through that valley, pass through that suffering, pass through that trial, pass through that difficulty, and God is going to help you in the midst of what you're facing. So the psalmist begins to describe, while I'm walking in that valley, while I'm walking with all of these pilgrims, while I'm walking on this spiritual journey toward home, there's going to be some valleys that I'm going to walk in, but I'm going to walk through them by the grace of God, and it's not going to hinder me in my journey home. And every person must recognize tonight, just as the psalmist said, yes, I'm walking in a valley, but I'm passing through that valley, and I got my eyes set toward home, because I know there is a brighter day coming and a better day coming when I will be in the courts of my Savior. I will be in the courts of praise, and the heavenly host will begin to praise and magnify the Son of God, and I'm going to be a part of that heavenly journey. Amen. What glorious daybreak. But as I'm passing through the valley of tears and the valley of sorrow, there's some things I need to learn in the midst of the valley of Baca.
Yes, hallelujah.
Notice what it says. When passing through the valley of Baca, make it a well, and the rain also filleth the pools. And in verse 7 says, they go from strength to strength. Every one of them in Zion appeareth before God. Now again, remember the difficulty of their circumstance. They're down past Egypt, down in Saudi Arabia, 500 miles away from Jerusalem, and 500 miles away from the place called home, and the tabernacle of the Lord, and to the hill of Mount Zion. It's a place not only of difficulty, but it's a place of desolation. You got to remember, in those days, just as it is now, a desert place brings no life. It brings no water. It brings no sustaining. They have no way to take care of their families and their farms and their cattle and everything that they have with them. It's a desperation place and a place of desolation. These Jewish pilgrims were living in exile in a land where there was no God. They were pilgrims and strangers in this weary land, but they were longing toward the courts of Mount Zion. They were longing toward home. They wanted to get to the king's house. They wanted to get home where they feel no pain or suffering or sorrow anymore. But on that spiritual journey and on this physical journey that these pilgrims were facing, they came through the desolation, understanding they were walking in a land that did not want God. You take that in reference to us on this spiritual journey. Yeah, we're walking as pilgrims headed toward the king's palace. Yeah. But on the way, we're going to face people that are going to be God deniers. We're going to face people that does not want to know your Jesus. Yep. We're going to face people that does not want to know God. But in the midst of that, may God help us to keep our eyes toward home. Yes. Keep our eyes toward heaven. Yes. Keep our eyes toward glory. Because there is a better day coming. We're just passing through this veil of sorrow. Right. We're just passing through this day of trouble. Hallelujah. And this day's going to be over. And we'll stand before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So in this valley of despair, in this valley of Baca, in this valley of tears, keep your eyes upon the Son of God, who will never leave you nor forsake you, but will help you every step of the way.
Amen.
It's a place of difficulty. It was a place that they found, a place of desolation. They long for the house of God. They long for Mount Zion. They long for the home that they had been a part of for all of those years. And these exiled pilgrims, as they're passing through this journey, and it's a desert place, It's not only a place of difficulty and desolation, but it's a very dry place because it's a desert. There's no water there. There's no refreshing there. There's no help there. And as they're walking through this dry place, they're thinking the whole time, I wonder, can I just make it long enough to get to Mount Zion? Can I just make it long enough to get to the household of God?
Yeah.
Can I make it long enough through this dry and weary land to get to that place where I know living water's at? And I'm telling you, it may look dry. It may look desolate. It may look depressing. It may look hopeless. But you hang on. Hallelujah. We're about to get home. We're about to go to our heavenly mountainside. We're about to go to that place where we'll be at the King's table throughout all eternity.
Yeah.
So cheer up, child of God. There is a better day coming for the household of faith.
Amen.
Bless it.
In Israel's time frame, they had two rainy seasons. They had the early rain, which hit them around January and February. And then they had the latter rain, which hit them around August and September. But it's a very dry place. If you were to go there today, there's not much raining going on inside of the land of Israel. It's a very desolate place. It's a very dry place. And can you imagine them taking all of those pilgrims, all their cattle, all their sheep, everything that they had with them, and I could see those pilgrims marching in that dry land. I could see them marching in one triumphant line as they're marching towards Zion, and they're thinking the whole time, if I could just get to Mount Zion, if I could just get home, if I could just get to that place, everything would be okay. And there's a longing that ought to be in the hearts of God's people.
Yes,
it's a dry place. Yes, it's a dreary place. Yes, it's a difficult place. But if I could just hang in there long enough, the trumpet's about to sound. I'm about to enter into the King's palace. I'm about to go home to my heavenly Mount Zion and be with my Savior. And it'll be worth every mile of the journey for the household of faith. So don't look at the dryness here. Don't look at the difficulty here. Don't look at the problems on this side of eternity. That's going to pass away in just a flicker of time. When we get in the presence of our Redeemer, it'll be worth every mile of the journey when we see Jesus face to face. It's a dry place. Not only is it it's a dry place and it's a desolation, a place of desolation and a place of difficulty, but they were dealing with a place of discouragement. Because remember, they did not have a plane, they did not have a car, they did not have any means whatsoever. They had to walk or ride a donkey or something of that nature, and they're 500 miles away from home. And it looked like all hope was going to be gone. Because no doubt along that long journey, they faced sickness. Somebody got sick along the journey. They faced death. Somebody died along that journey. They faced sorrow and difficulty. No doubt their heart was broken and their heart was battered along that 500-mile journey. But the whole time, they're thinking, as they said in verses 1 and 2, yea, my corpse and my heart and my soul fainted for the house of God. If we can just get to Mount Zion, we know everything will be all right.
Amen.
And you can see those little pilgrims marching together, step by step. Yes, they got battered. Yes, they went through the storm. Yes, they went through the difficulty. Yes, they faced the problems on every side. Yes, they faced somebody in their family getting sick. Yes, they even faced having to bury a loved one along the journey. But the whole time they're thinking, I'm about home. I'm about home. I'm about home. If I could just get to my outside, I know everything will be all right. And we can sing the praises of the Lord. And we can magnify the Lord if we can just get to Mount Zion. And them little weary pilgrims, them little battered wayward pilgrims on this spiritual journey home. As they're marching that way, they're thinking the whole time, hey, if I can just get there. There was a desire within their heart. They didn't want to quit along the journey.
Amen.
They didn't want to throw in their towel along the journey. They didn't want to stop short of the journey.
Right,
they kept their eyes fastened toward that heavenly home, Mount Zion, because they were hungry for the courts of the Lord.
Yeah.
And may God give us a desire in this dry and weary land, in this place of difficulty. Keep on marching. Hallelujah. You're about home. Keep on looking to that heavenly city. We're about to be with the King, sitting at the King's table.
Amen.
And it'll be worth every mile of the journey. And keep your face set toward heaven, because it'll be worth everything.
Hallelujah.
I think about what these little pilgrims must have been facing. They not only faced this place of discouragement, because they were dealing with hunger. They were dealing with thirst. They were dealing with obstacles. They were dealing with the hot desert and the cold nights. They were dealing with the animals coming after them in the clefts and in the crevices of the mountain peaks as they walked through the desert floor. They were dealing with sickness. They were dealing with death. They were dealing with trials. They were dealing with problems on every side, but they kept their eyes toward Mount Zion.
Amen.
Because they knew if they could just step into the courts of God, everything would be all right. If they could just hear the people of faith sing again, everything would be all right. If they could just step into the courts of the praises of the Lord, everything would be all right. And sometimes you got to get your mind and your attitude and your heart away from the troubles and the difficulties that you're facing on every time, and start looking way past this little world to the world to come, to what God's got prepared for those that love Him. It's going to be a rejoicing day and a praising day and a magnificent day and a wonderful day when we step into the courts of our praise. I think about not only is it a place of discouragement they faced, a place of dryness they faced, a place of desolation, a place of difficulty. But you see the desperation that was presented. For in verse number 2, my soul longeth, yea, even fainteth for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. They're facing the difficulty and the darkness and the dryness and the desolation and all that they're facing. And the whole time, there's a desperation in their soul and in their heart that if they could just get into the courts of the praise and the tabernacle and get into the onto the hill of Mount Zion, everything would be okay. So let me encourage you. You've got to have that desperation in your heart and that desire within your soul that in the midst of the difficulty, you've got to keep your eyes and your faith upon the Son of God.
Amen.
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 But I want you to notice, in this valley of Baca, which means a valley of tears and weeping, what are we to do until we get home? What are we to do until we get home? Number one, we've got to depend upon God's promises and God's word. If you depend upon your flesh and you depend upon your feelings, you'll get out of God's will. And you'll quit along this pilgrim journey. If you depend upon yourself, you'll quit and get out of this spiritual journey home. If you depend upon your thought process, you'll get out of this journey called home. If you look to somebody else and look and trust them instead of the Savior, there's going to be times when you're going to be let down and you're going to get out before you get home. But may God encourage you tonight. There's over 3,500 promises in this Bible. Get you one of them and depend upon him and trust God, because in the midst of this difficulty, in the midst of this battle, and in the midst of this journey home, I've got to know that I can trust in my Creator. I've got to know that I can trust in my God. I've got to understand that He promised He'd never leave me nor forsake me, and He'd be with me every day. He promised me that He would take care of us. He would bless us and He would help us. So child of God, get you some promises. Get in the Word of God. Become a student of the Bible. Because as we get in this difficult journey home, there's going to be battles on every side. There's going to be storms on every side. But I know, hallelujah, He knows how to speak peace to the storm, the difficulty and the problem. And He can undergird you. He can help you. He can lift you. And the Word of God can take you to the height that will help you in through and by what you're facing. So depend upon the promises of God. In your valley of Baca, depend upon the promises of God. That's why the scripture says, Jeremiah 33:3, call unto me and I will answer thee and will show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Get you some promises. Get something from the Word of God that will help you in your midnight journey. Get you a promise from the Word of God that you can stand upon and cling to in the midst of you going to Mount Zion.
Yes.
Number two, understand, just as they were aware of, that deliverance was on the way. It may look hopeless now, but you mark it down, deliverance is on the way.
Amen.
I've read the last chapter.
Amen. Amen.
We are on the winning side.
We are.
I'm not going down, but I'm going up to be with my King.
Amen.
I'm not going to be defeated, because He already declared for time and for eternity, I've said it is finished, to Tetelestai. The race is won and the race is over. And because He got up on that third resurrection morning, He gave victory over death, hell, and the grave to the household of faith. And the devil can't take me to hell, because I'm saved by the grace of God. And because I'm saved by the grace of God, I'm marching toward Mount Zion. And one glorious daybreak, this veil of sorrow is going to be over. The problems of life is going to pass away, and I'll step into the rewards in the presence of my King for all eternity, where we'll thank Him and praise Him and glorify Him. So child of God, understand, it may look dark here, but deliverance is on the way. It may look like there's death on every side, but deliverance is on the way. It may look like it's hopeless on every corner, but deliverance is on the way. You're about home. You're about to hear the trumpet sound. You're about to stand before the King. You're about to get to the King's palace. So right before you get there, don't quit. Don't throw in your towel. Don't stop short of the glory of what God's about to show you and do for you. Keep your eyes toward Him. Keep loving Him. Keep loving each other, because we're about to see the Savior.
Amen.
Deliverance is on the way. That's what encourages me. It encourages me to understand this is not all there is to it.
Amen.
If I looked at you and you looked at me, and sometimes we look so depressed and so defeated and so discouraged, I quit and you would quit. But I'm glad it does not rest on you and it does not rest on me. Yeah. It's already been paid for. The journey's paid for in full. I'm about to stand before the King who saved me, who redeemed me, who washed me in His precious blood. And because of that, I understand that deliverance is on the way. This is not all there is to it. I'm about to get home and you are too. But until we get there, we're pilgrims on a journey headed toward Mount Zion. Now think of this. Not only must you depend upon the Word of God, and you must understand deliverance is on the way, but I don't understand this next verse. For in this verse, the psalmist said, in verse number 6, who passing through the valley of Baca, make it a well. Now, how am I supposed to make a well in the midst of my weeping? How am I supposed to make a well in the midst of my problem? How am I supposed to make a well in the midst of my difficulty? And the psalmist said, while I'm passing through as pilgrims headed toward Mount Zion, I need to get me a spiritual shovel and I need to start digging a well.
Amen.
And you say, what is he talking about?
Amen.
He's got family behind him. He's got acquaintances and loved ones down the line of this journey. He's got people he may not even be aware of or may not even know that's walking behind him. And somewhere along that journey, they're going to need some water.
Yep, right.
And somewhere along that journey, their family's going to need refreshment. And somewhere along that journey, they're going to need some help. And so the psalmist said, instead of complaining, instead of griping, instead of groaning, instead of saying it's not fair, give me a shovel.
Yeah.
I'm going to start digging a well. I'm going to make me a place. So when the rains come, the early or the latter rain comes, there's going to be a pit that's going to become a well.
Amen.
That when they're coming behind me, they're going to have a place to drink. They're going to have a place where water's at. They're going to have a place of refreshing. They're going to have a place on their journey to Mount Zion that they can understand, hey, I know God and I know he's real.
Yeah.
And there ought to be some wells, yeah, that we're digging to let them know God's answered my prayer. Let them know God's worked a miracle. Let them know God's helped me in the midnight hour. Let them know that God did it for me. And if God can do it for me, he can do it for you.
Right.
So get you a spiritual shovel. And instead of looking at the circumstance, instead of looking at the difficulty, instead of looking at the problem, get you a shovel and say, praise God, I'm just going to keep digging on my way to Mount Zion because there's somebody coming after me that needs a drink of water. And I've got to lay something in front of them that will help them for the glory of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
And the psalmist said, while passing through the valley of Baca, headed toward Mount Zion, they dug a well.
Amen.
If I'm digging a well, I don't have time to worry about what somebody else is saying.
Right.
If I'm digging a well, and I'm involved in leaving something behind for somebody coming behind me,
yep,
I don't have time to worry about what others may think or believe about me.
Amen.
If I'm digging a well and I've got my eyes set toward Mount Zion and I know there's a bunch of people coming behind me that need a drink of water, and if I'm involved spiritually digging them a spiritual well that they can come behind me and get a drink of water, that living water of the Son of God, then I don't have to worry about my circumstance or my problems or my difficulty. Why? Because I'm involved in making sure somebody else has a place to drink some water. Somebody else has a place of refreshment that God can help them. And while I'm trying to help them, guess what? God begins to help me and let me see I'm closer to Mount Zion than I've ever been. Son, just keep on digging. Everything's going to be okay. So tonight, I want to challenge you as I leave this service this evening, get you a spade, get you a shovel spiritually, and start digging a well on this valley of Mount Zion, and wait till you get home to see what God's going to do of all those people that's come behind you thirsty,
amen,
that needed a drink of water.
Amen.
And he said, while passing through the valley of Baca, again, you need to look at that phrase, while passing through.
That's right.
Wow. It didn't mean you stayed there. You're just passing through.
Yeah.
While passing through this valley of Baca, headed toward home, I'm supposed to dig a well.
That's right.
That others that come behind me can see that God was faithful for you and God was faithful for me. And if he helped you and he helped me, he'll help them.
Yes, right.
He will. Bless him.
So I can either cover up the well spiritually and be one of those that says, Whose despair, agony on me, sitting under my juniper tree, hanging my harps on the willow, saying it's not fair, crying the blues. It ain't gonna change it. It ain't gonna change what you're facing. Crying the blues ain't gonna help us. What's gonna help us? Mount Zion.
Amen.
Amen.
What's gonna help us? Home. What's gonna help us? Getting close to God. What's going to help us? Being involved in digging a well. For somebody else that's coming behind me to know that if God was faithful for you and God was faithful for me, he'll be faithful for them.
Amen.
So I want to challenge you while passing through the valley of Baca, which means weeping and tears. In the desolation, in the death, in the discouragement, and all the stuff that they were facing, God told them, dig a well while you're making your way home. So people coming behind them would have a place of water to get some help from. And that should be the challenge that we have tonight. Keep on digging. Don't quit. Don't throw in your spiritual towel. Don't sit down and just moan in the circumstances. Just start digging. Start digging. Watch what God can do. Watch how God can work. Start digging. Yes, it may be difficult. Yes, as I'm digging, I may be weeping. As I'm digging, I may be broken. As I'm digging, I may be sorrowful. As I'm digging, I may be in pain. As I'm digging, I may feel like that all hope is gone, but all he asked me to do was keep on digging. And if I'll keep digging, God will get me home and let me bless some people on this journey.
Amen, brother.
That they'll have some water, that they'll have something that can refresh them before they ever get to the house with the king.
Yes.
Praise God, brother.
Oh, I love the Word of God, don't you?
Amen.
You ever seen that verse before? While passing through the valley of Baca, make it a well. I've been around some old timers. Remember when I was youth pastor at Temple Baptist Church, there's a man by the name of Frank. He was dying of cancer. And he was in and out of the hospital a lot. But old Frank didn't wheel him in the wheelchair, and he'd want to be pushed to the front. He wants up there where the spit's at. And they push him to the front. And anyway, I mean, the choir gets singing, anything happening. I mean, he just lift up them little bony hands and praise God. You go to the hospital, he'd be laying there in that bed. He'd have them arms up there praising God.
Amen.
He'd get them doctors around his bed. He'd just start talking about Jesus, what Jesus has done for him. He started praising God. They put him in the hospice. He said, "Preacher," he said, "I want to let you know before you, but I want you to keep on praising God.
Amen.
It'll be worth it when we see him face to face."
Hallelujah.
I went through some difficulty. I went through some trials. I'm about to die, but I know this. Absent from this body is present with the Lord. He'd get all of those hospice workers around his bed and then start scratching their head because he wasn't sad. He said, "Praise God, I get to see him before you do."
Amen.
Amen.
He was happy about the state God had let him ride in and walk in and the difficulty God had let him experience because he knew there was a better day coming, a brighter day coming. And Amen. Satan can't do anything with that kind of Christian.
That's right.
Because they got victory beyond victory beyond victory.
That's right.
Because they learned how to dig a well in their valley.
Yeah.
And in the midst of their valley, they left some wells of water that somebody could come behind them and get a drink of living water that would encourage and help them in their day of difficulty. So tonight, as we started Sunday morning on Shake It Off, as we're ending on Wednesday night headed toward Mount Zion, I challenge you, keep on digging.
Amen.
Dig a well and let God use your life to bring glory and honor to Him and to help somebody else along your spiritual journey.
Yes.
That when they come through the same valley of Baca, when they come through the same discouragement and the same defeat, they'll have a well of water that they can drink from, understanding if God was faithful for Mama and Grandpa and Mama and Daddy and sister and brother, He'll be faithful for me.
Amen.
So dig a well.
Right.
Instead of looking at your problems, start digging a well in the midst of your problems and watch what God can do as you start digging.
Yes.
Father, thank you for this time together. Lord, I pray that these services have been a help to your people. Lord, I pray that these services have been an encouragement to your people. And Lord, I pray as we get around the altar tonight, may we be more determined as we leave this place this evening, God, to do our part in digging a well for the glory of God. Challenge us, help us, stir us. Help us as your people, God, to be faithful to you. God, as we're pilgrims on a journey to Mount Zion, headed home, God, let us dig wells on this journey. In Jesus' name, I want us to stand all over the building. How many would just get out of those seats and come on this last service? You may not kneel, you can come sit on these front pews, but you come find you a place and say, God, help me. God, in these last days, on this spiritual journey, on this day, in the days of the Valley of Baca, God, help me to learn how to dig wells for the glory of God. I want you to step out and come all over the building. All over the building. You come. Let the Lord help you tonight. Let the Lord help you tonight. Oh God, help us, God, in these days of difficulty. God, days of desolation, days of dryness. God, days of discouragement. God, days of despair. God, in the midst of us walking through this pilgrim journey headed toward home, God, let us learn how to dig wells. God, let us learn how to leave something behind that will create a thirst in somebody else that'll want what we have. God, don't let us go out of here in the smoke. God, don't let us go out of here in the darkness and the dryness of this day, but God, let us go out of here revived and stirred and understand, God, you've got a purpose in mind. You got a will in mind, and God, you want us to be an influence to those coming behind us for the glory of God. God, touch us and breathe on us and help us in these days. Lord, we'll give you praise and thanksgiving for all that you do. And all God's people said,
amen
and amen. So what are we going to do in our valley of Baca?
Dig away.
Dig away. Dig away. Amen.
You know, it goes to show you, I've been pastoring for many years, and even a pastor can always learn something. And I have learned something this week in revival. I have learned something from the Word of God. And I've learned to shake it off, whatever comes your way. And I've learned to dig a well in the desert, bless God. And all going from haywire, learn to dig a well and keep on and leave something for those behind you. Leave something for somebody behind you. You know, one of the services there, we were talking about pouring a glass of water and giving the people water, give them something to drink, give them something to drink. Well, you know, I've tried in the past 39 years, it's coming January, this church. I've tried to put the word out there, give you something to feast on, something to grow on, and something to drink and quench your thirst. And there's nothing to quench your thirst like the word of God.
Right.
It's there with you through whatever.
Amen.
We appreciate you coming tonight. And I trust that you'll have a wonderful week. And let's pray for Brother Gray, hearts and hands. And let's just pray for each other. I tell you, it seems like it's just unreal that it's come to this end. But let's don't let it end tonight.
Amen.
If you've truly been blessed in your heart, don't let it end tonight. Let's keep the revival spirit going. Keep the love of God going. And brother, I tell you, God will bless our church. Amen. All right, is there anything else now before we can stand and dismiss? Not let's all stand. Remember our service Sunday morning at 9:45. Before you get here, already making plans myself to be here. Amen. 9:45.
Amen.
If you don't have a local church, we encourage you to come down and be with us. We're just a country church, believing standing on the Word of God without compromising. Brother, we stand on the King James Version. Amen. Trust in the Lord. We do our part, and trust God to do His part. We'll dig our spiritual well. God will give God will put the water in. God will help us. And let's just pray for each other. And I'll tell you, I wouldn't leave without shaking Brother Greg's hand and telling you love him.
You appreciate
him preaching his heart out. He's serving services. This is the fifth service he's preached for us. He's brought the message from the Word of God. So we appreciate everybody coming. So nothing else. Brother Dean, if you would dismiss the service, we'll pray.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, just thank you for this revival that you've given us, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you just touch our hearts, Lord, and lead us close to thee. God, we pray you pour your spirit out on us, Lord, that others will see you through us and not us, Lord God. And we pray for Brother Greg as he goes on his journey, preaching your word, that you just keep touching him and keep bringing sinners in, Lord God, and save them before it's eternally too late. For we know our time is short on this earth, Lord. And just let us remember, Lord, that this time on this earth, we will pass through sorrows and troubles and trials and Lord, but it'll be worth it all when we get to Zion, Lord God. And just help us to keep digging that well, Lord God, so others can see you, Lord God, for it's not us, it's you, which worketh the will and the to do for each and every one of us. And Lord, we'll be careful to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor for it all. Just watch over us and keep us safe, Lord, as we go home our separate ways and bring us back to the next appointed time. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.